Hello everyone. So today we will start our chapter 4, that is the circulatory system. And in this chapter we are going to learn about how the blood flow throughout our body and how it is just take all the minerals and nutrients throughout the body. It will not only take all the minerals and nutrients, but also it will also deliver the kind of oxygen, various kind of hormones and enzymes throughout our body. Okay, so we are going to discuss all those things in this chapter. So let's start now. So for performing several functions like growth, respiration, excretion, motion, action, etc., a continuous supply of good nutrients to muscles, nerves, bones and other organs is essential. Means if we want to increase our growth, if we want better respiration, for the excretion means the removal of the waste materials, thereafter the motion, action and these kind of things, and if we want to perform these kind of functions through our body, then we basically need a good amount of nutrients to our muscles, nerves, bones and all the essential organs which is present in our body. In short, our body need several types of nutrients to perform those functions. The process by which the movement of nutrients, oxygen, hormones, enzymes, minerals, carbon dioxide and other toxic excretory system takes place through the liquid medium of the living body is called circulation. What does it mean? It means the movement of nutrients, as I had already told you before, that circulatory system is all about the movement of nutrients, oxygen, hormone, enzymes, minerals, carbon dioxide and other toxic excretory substance, so that it will just move throughout the body. And how it will move? It will move through a medium that is a liquid medium, and that medium is blood. Obviously, we all know that. Thereafter, the medium of circulation in man and other higher animals are blood and limbs, and the system which deal with the circulation of blood and limb is called as circulatory system. Means all those circulation in man or any kind of higher animals is going through the medium of blood or limb. Okay, these are the two conditions, these are the two things through which the nutrients and several materials will transfer. Thereafter, this is the part which deals with the circulation of blood and limb. That's why it is called as circulatory system. So in the circulatory system, we can see that the system of vessels in an animal's body that transport essential substance to and from the different part of the body is called circulatory system. Means what? In the animal's body, there has been a different vessels present, and through that vessels, our body send different types of substance to the different part of the body. Okay, like for the if the blood is just moving from the heart to the lungs, to the kidney, to the other part of the cells, they need different kind of things. And if the blood is coming back to the heart, like the excretion or the removal part with the waste material, it will come through the different things that is we are going to discuss in this chapter. There are three things which is basically we need for the circulatory system, that is the heart, the blood and blood vessels. So let's start with the heart. Heart is situated in the center of the chest between the lungs and lies just under the breastbone above the diaphragm. So we all know that the heart is situated in the center of the chest and it is between the lungs and just under the breastbone. Means the bones which is present in our chest is called the breastbone. Okay, our heart has four chambers. Two upper chambers are the left and right atria, which is also called as auricles, and there are two lower chambers that are called left and right ventricles. Okay, The chambers on the left are separated from those on the right by septum, and the blood flow between the top and bottom chambers is controlled by valves. So we can see that our heart has four chambers. The upper two chambers are called auricles and the lower two chambers are called ventricles. In the chamber, they are separated on the left, okay, and right. Okay, there has been a two part and it is being separated by a septum, means the wall which dividing the heart into two part is called septum, and the blood flow between the top and bottom chamber is controlled by valves. Valve is the thing so that if the blood is just moved out from the heart, it will not move backward, so the valve will control the movement of the blood. Thereafter, the left atrium. The left atrium will receive the oxygenated blood from the lungs through the pulmonary veins, and the blood then flow into the left ventricles. It will just send the blood into the left ventricle, which you can see in the diagram already given, and which is just pump it out into the body through the aorta. Okay, it will just pump out the the blood are ready to move into the our body, so it will move through a aorta, that is a blood vessel. Thereafter, the blood circulate through the body, it lose oxygen, means as the blood will start to circulate throughout the body, the cells will try to take the oxygen and it will give the carbon dioxide to the blood. So what happened, the blood will lose its oxygen and the blood will become deoxygenated blood, and the deoxygenated blood will return to the heart via right atrium. In the right atrium, it will get back to the heart, and then it will be back to the ventricle. Ventricle will do what? It will just give the blood to the lungs, so that lungs will take the oxygen and mix with the blood, so that the blood will be called as oxygenated blood. Thereafter, the left side of the heart is stronger than the right side, because the right side only blood pumps to the lungs and back, while the left side pumps blood around the whole body. So there is a basic question which is just arising, that why our left side of the heart is stronger. So our left side of heart is stronger because the left side of heart is send all the blood into the body, like in the all of our body it will just send the blood, but the right side is not that much strong because it is just pumping the blood to the lungs and it will just take back from the lungs. That way is it it is weaker than the left side of the heart. Thereafter, let's move to the blood vessels. In the blood vessels, we can see that the blood vessels are branched tubes. Okay, blood vessels are branched tubes extended from the heart to all part of the body. There are three major types of blood vessels, that is the arteries that carry blood from the heart, veins that return blood to the heart, capillaries means extremely tiny vessels connecting the arteries and the veins. So we can see that the blood vessels are nothing but a branched tube, and these are the extending from the heart to all part of the body, means they are just connected throughout the body, and this is the reason through which the blood will send it to the each and every part of the body. And in this criteria, we have three kind of blood vessels. First one is arteries, it will just carry blood from the heart. Thereafter, veins, it will return blood to the heart, means artery will carry the blood from the heart and move it throughout the body. And thereafter, when the blood is deoxygenated, the blood will move back to the heart through veins, not through the arteries. And thereafter, capillaries are extremely small vessels which is connecting between the vein and the arteries. Okay, so when the blood is pumped out of the heart into the arteries, it forced out at high pressure by contraction of the muscular ventricles. Means when the blood is pumped out from the heart, it is forced at high pressure by contraction. Means when the heart will contract, it will pump the blood in the upward side. Thereafter, arteries require strong wall to withstand the pressure of the blood flowing through them. So artery requires a very strong wall. That why our artery is quite thicker than the veins. They have the elastic tissue in their walls and can stretch and recoil with the force of blood. Means they can stretch and recoil also. Thereafter, the wall of the artery also contain muscle, and this determines the amount of blood that flow through them and the blood pressure. Means the artery are the reason through which we can determine the flow of blood and the blood pressure also. Thereafter, we can see as the blood travels through the body, the arteries divided into smaller and smaller vessels. These are capillaries. Okay, so the capillaries will do what? It will just take the food and oxygen and other materials to the body cells, and thereafter take the remove waste product, and then it will allow a passage of substance through them. Means it will just allow to send the materials from artery to vein or vein to artery. This is the basic thing he always used to do. Thereafter, as the blood continues its passage around the body, the capillaries merge again to form veins through which the blood is returned to the heart. Means when the blood will continue its passage around the body, the capillaries will what? It will merge. Merge means connected. It is just connected to the veins, and it will just return the blood to the veins, and thereafter the veins will take all the blood to the heart. Thereafter, by the time blood reaches the vein, its pressure has been greatly reduced and flow is much slower. Means the vein in the artery, we can see that the blood pressure was quite high. The veins is different. It is the opposite of that. In this place, the pressure of the blood is much slower than the arteries, and the walls of vein do not need to be thick, and they are quite small and thin. Okay. In comparison to arteries. So I'm going to end the chapter over here. In our next chapter, we are going to discuss about the difference between the arteries and veins. Okay, bye.